Hi and welcome. In this lecture, we're gonna talk a bit more about the idea of effectivity theories. And in particular, I'm gonna discuss with you how the idea of operators, which are of increasing dimension, will allow us to give an order in the priority with which we should consider interactions, okay? So the problem that we want to solve is the following. It's very simple. Remember that when we were writing interactions, so for instance, the interactions that we have considered between a pair of Dirac fermions and the massless vector, photon, we just wrote something like this, G, A mu, psi bar, gamma mu, psi. But this, of course, is just one of the infinitely many possible interactions that we can construct out of these particles. For instance, why shall we use an interaction which is like this? Psi bar, sigma mu nu, psi f mu nu. This is completely invariant under the gauge transformation. It is invariant under Lorentz transformation. So it is a perfectly valid interaction. Or why don't we write something like this? Psi bar, psi, multiplied by psi bar, psi. So this is symptomatic of an intrinsic problem that we have in quantum field theory. So once we establish and we fix once and for all what is the particle content of our theory, then we have infinitely many possible interactions that we can write, okay? So how should we order them? Is there a rationale that will allow us to select what are the most important and what are the second order terms or third order terms and so on and so forth? And the idea behind this classification comes from a classification called effective field theories technique or ideology. Okay, so let me illustrate the point in a simpler theory with respect to this one. So I'm just going to consider the theory of a massless scalar field, okay, with a Z2 symmetry. Okay, so let me define what that is. Later on in the course, we will apply the same idea to this theory, which is QED. Now, just to illustrate the point, let me consider a simple theory. So I'm going to consider the theory of a massless scalar. So the scalar will be taken real just for simplicity. And I want to understand what are the possible terms that I can write when I impose a global Z2 symmetry. Okay, so this Z2 symmetry is there just to simplify a bit the kind of terms that we can write in our Lagrange. Okay, there is no deeper meaning behind it. It's just to make our lives and the discussion a bit simpler. And the definition of this being a Z2 symmetry is like the following. Phi goes into minus itself. Okay. So if this is a symmetry of the Lagrangian, you see immediately that it's scaling all the terms that involve the odd power of phi, okay? Because an odd power of phi, like phi to the cube, would go into minus phi to the cube. So that term wouldn't be invariant under the symmetry, okay? So let me write the terms in the Lagrangian. So of course, I'm going to have the kinetic term. So this is going to be 1 half d phi squared. Then I'm taking for simplicity n equals 0, because if you remember when we were discussing the EFT ideology in the lecture number 0, I said that there is an intrinsic maximum energy of validity of my quantum field theory. Okay. So I just want to show you what happens when we have a unique scale around. And if I introduce a mass different from zero, we would have two scales in our problem, lambda, the cutoff, and the mass of the scalar. Since I want to just make a point, I'm going to assume that the scalar is massless. Okay, so that we can just discuss our physics in terms of a unique scale. Of course, you can extend the discussion, but that's something that we will see later on. Okay, so I won't write the quadratic term because that would be associated with the mass of the particle. But then I can write the quartic term, lambda phi to the fourth, and then I can move on. Right, for instance, I will have a term phi to the sixth. So let me write this coefficient k1. I will have a term which is of type phi squared DeFi square, and let me call this coefficient K2, and so on and so forth. Okay, I have infinite terms that I can write just with this particle content that respect this. Okay, so you see that I have higher powers of the scalar field, but I can also combine our higher powers of the derivatives with higher powers of the fields. Okay, and so I can play this game and continue in writing this. Now, in order to understand how the effective field theory idea will allow us to give a classification which of what are the most important effects in quantum field theory, let me use dimensional analysis. Okay, so as I promised in the very first lecture, in lecture number zero, dimensional analysis was going to play a fundamental role in this course. And this is the first time that we really see how this, why this role is so important. Okay, so let me first compute the dimension of the scalar and then compute the dimension of each one of these terms. Okay, so each one of these terms is called an operator. So this is one operator. This is another operator different. This is another operator, and so on. Okay, so all the terms that we write in our Lagrange take the name of operators, okay? Because they are a combination of more fundamental quantum operators, such as the quantum fields, so they are themselves operators. That's the reason behind it, okay? So what is the dimension of the phi operator, of the phi quantum field? Well, we can see it directly from the kinetic term, right? Because if you remember, the action S must have dimension zero in natural units because we are taking h bar equal to one. Since h bar is equal to one, it's a number, it's dimensionless. So the action, which has the same dimension of h bar, must also be dimensionless. And this is simply the integral over space time of our Lagrangian density, right? So if I now use units of energy, you remember that length has dimension of one over energy. So this means that this term has dimension minus four in units of energy. And then I need to sum the dimension of the Lagrangian density, which from here, you immediately see that it must be equal to four. So the dimension of the Lagrangian density is necessarily equal to four. Now let's go here. You see that two derivatives plus of times two times the field must give me the Lagrange. So if I look here and I remember that the derivative being d in dx, okay, with some index mu, has dimension of one over length, meaning that it has dimension of energy. So this scales with the dimension of energy. You see immediately that phi must necessarily have dimension one for this term to sum up to dimension four. Okay, so this is the first information that dimensional analysis is giving us. The dimension of the quantum scalar field is equal to plus one. Okay, you can repeat the same game with the other fields, and I will leave you as an exercise to discover what are the quantum the dimension, the natural units and energy units of the fermion field and of the vector field. Okay, very good. So now that we know what are the dimensions of phi, we can classify the dimensions of all these terms. So let's do it. It's a very simple exercise. So this is dimension four by definition, right? Because I'm using this to deduce that the dimension of phi is equal to one. This has four times the dimension of phi, so it has dimension four. So this is an operator of d equal four. This you see that is an operator of dimension six powers of phi. This has four powers of phi here and two powers of the derivative. So the dimension here is the four powers of phi plus the two powers of the derivative. So this is also a term of dimension six, and so on and so forth. Okay. So you see that as we start adding powers of phi or of derivatives, the dimension of the operator, as is to be expected, started to increase. Okay. And this is what will allow us to give a classification. Now, there is a smarter way to write these terms, which again uses the idea of dimensional analysis. So under my hypothesis, there is only one dimension full scale in my game, which is the cutoff lambda of my theory. Okay. I suggest that if you don't remember what I'm talking about, you go back to lecture zero to see what the meaning of this cutoff is. Is the maximum energy at which my quantum field theory is valid. So since it is the only scale around, I can use it to write the dimensionful parameter as some dimensionless parameter times something, some combination of lambda or some power of lambda that gives the correct dimension. So this lambda is dimensionless, right? So I don't have to worry about this. This K1, so here, so more properly, I should say that dimension six is the dimension of the operator, not of the coefficient. Okay. The coefficient is there in such a way that the overall dimension of the Lagrangian is equal to 4. So this coefficient here, you see that it has dimension minus 2, in such a way that 6 minus 2 gives 4, which is the correct dimension. And so this K1 can be written as some dimensionless coefficient, which I'm going to call G1, divided by the cutoff square of my theory. So this has correctly dimension minus 2 in units of energy. Okay. So you see that dimensional analysis is telling me that this interaction should be suppressed by two powers of the maximum energy of validity of my QFT. What about K2? Well, again, the dimension of phi squared d phi squared is 6. So the dimension of K2 should be equal to minus 2. So again, I can write this K2 as another coefficient. So let me call it H1, which is dimensionless, divided by lambda squared. Okay. So both these terms are suppressed by 1 over lambda squared. Okay. Times some undetermined, still undetermined, dimensionless coefficient, which I'm calling G1 in one case, and H1. Okay. So what I'm going to show you now is that whenever we consider the amplitudes in our Feynman diagrams, and we go to very low energy, to energy which are much lower than the cutoff of the theory, then only a finite set of these operators are important. Okay. So the idea is precisely the one that we saw in the example of the electrostatic, of the electromagnetic static field, yeah, the potential. So as we go very far away, so we take the long distance limit from the source, then only a few terms are important, the monopole, the dipole, and the quadrupole. And more terms are important as we take the short distance limit. Here, the long distance limit is the low energy limit, if you remember what the natural limits are telling us. And so again, the lower the energy, the fewer the terms that will be important. Okay. So before doing that, we need to know what are the dimensions of our amplitudes. So let's take... let's open a small parenthesis with the dimension of the amplitudes. So if you remember, in one of the previous lectures, I wrote the amplitude that appears, for instance, in the expression for the cross section or for the decay width in the following way. I said that the amplitude for the initial state going to the final state is equal to the following object. Is the final state, the T matrix, and then I put here the initial state. Actually, what appears in the actual computation of the Feynman rules or of the Dyson series and so on is not precisely this quantity. Okay, so I didn't tell that before because I didn't need it. Now we're going to add a layer of complexity, but it's something which is closely related, which is defined in the following way. Since four momentum is always conserved, it is convenient to factorize explicitly one factor of the delta that expresses the conservation of momentum. Okay, so this object will be written in the following way. It's 2 times pi to the fourth. This is conventional, it's just to take rid of some 2 pi factor which float around. Then I have a four-dimensional delta function, which is imposing the conservation of momentum between the initial and the final state. And then here there is the proper matrix element or the proper amplitude. Okay. So this is the object that we compute using Feynman rules, not this. The difference between the two is a factor of 2 pi to the fourth and a conservation of momentum. If you notice in the previous lecture, when I was showing you the explicit example of a computation of a cross-section, in my computation, I implicitly took into account momentum conservation. And this is due to the fact that I have factorized explicitly this fact. Okay, so it was not important for our discussion at the time. It's going to be important now because you see that this delta four factor carries dimensions, right? And if you think a bit about it, and I leave this as an exercise if you don't know it, this delta four carries the inverse dimensions, 4 power of the inverse dimension of what appears here. So this has dimension minus 4, okay, in units of energy as usual. So, in order to understand what are the dimensions of my amplitude, the only thing that I need to understand now is what is the dimension of this object here. And then I'm done, because I know that this has dimension minus 4. This will have a certain dimension. And if I want to compute the dimension of the amplitude that appears in the Feynman rules, I just take this dimension, the dimension of this amplitude here, plus 4. Okay. So let's consider a process involving n particles. Okay. So between the initial and the final states, in total, this interaction will involve n particles. So this is an n particle interaction. T, the operator T is dimensionless by definition, right? Because if you remember, it's the non-trivial part of the S matrix. The S matrix is the exponent, the time order exponential through the Dyson formula, the Dyson series. So being an exponential must be dimensionless. Okay, so T is dimensionless. So the whole dimension here comes from the one particle states. And if you remember, the one particle states, for instance, state with the initial state with momentum Q1, is obtained applying the creation operator to the vacuum. The vacuum is dimensionless by hypothesis. So all the dimensions here are carried either by creation operators or annihilation operators, depending if they appear on the right or on the left. Okay, so this means that the dimension of this object that I'm going after is equal to the dimension of the creation and annihilation operators to the power of n. Okay, so we need now to understand what are these dimensions here, and you can easily convince yourselves, and this is an exercise that I give you, that this has dimension minus one in units of energy, okay? In such a way that this has dimension minus n. Let me give you a hint on how to get to this result. You take the commutation relations, which are written in a suitable way, in such a way that there are delta factors that appear and energy factors, you remember. And from there, you deduce what are the dimensions of this alpha. Okay. So this object here has dimension minus n. This object here has dimension minus 4. So overall, we conclude that the dimensions of the amplitude A e to the f to which we are interested in is equal to 4 minus n. And this is the result that I want to get. So this is also giving you a non-trivial cross-check that when you use the Feynman rules and you write down your result, you can always check whether you're obtaining an amplitude which has the correct dimensions or not. Okay. So for instance, if you have 3 particles around, take the case of the decay of a particle into 2 other particles, the amplitude must have dimension plus 1 units of energy. If you consider a 2-to-2 scattering, it must have, so that you have 4 particles around, then this must have dimension 0, must be dimensionless. If you consider 2-to-3 scattering, so 5 particles around, then this will have dimension minus 1, and so on and so forth. Okay? Very good. So now we have all the ingredients to get to the point. So we're going to combine this information with this information. So let me cancel a few of these terms, and then so I will keep this Lagrangian, but instead of writing it like this, I will write directly here that this is g1 divided by the square, and this other term is going to be H1 divided by lambda squared. Okay. And then I will cancel the rest. Just writing up here that the dimension of the amplitude with n bodies is equal to 4 minus n. Okay. So let's consider a 2-2-2 scatter. Okay. So let's consider the amplitude 2-2-2. This is a 4-body or 4-point amplitude, right? So according to this formula, it must come out dimensionless. In the level of Feynman diagrams, this is simply something like this. You have phi phi in the initial state, phi phi in the final state. So what are the terms in this, or even better, what are the operators written in this Lagrange that contribute to this 2-2-2 scattering up? Well, you see that, first of all, I will have this term, lambda. Okay, so here I will have lambda. I won't bother in writing down the correct factors emerging from the Feynman rules or symmetry factors. Okay, they're not important for my argument. If you want, you can sit down and put the correct factors. Okay, so since I'm not writing the correct factors, let me say that this amplitude is not equal, but it has the following dependence. So there is a lambda here. We said the lambda is dimension 0, and this is exactly the dimension of the amplitude we are considering. But then, if I move on here, you see that this one doesn't contribute because it's a term that involves 6 phi particles. Here we just have 4. This one, on the other hand, does contribute because you see that we have 4 powers of our scalar field. So this is a 4-point amplitude. So here I need to add H1 divided by lambda squared. And now you see that when I add this term, the dimensions are not correct anymore because this is dimension 0 and this is dimension minus 2. So this means that I need to consider the dimension given by these derivatives to correctly infer what is the dependence or the form of this amplitude. So since derivatives are momenta are energies, so let's say that we give all the particles the same order of magnitude energy, for instance, of the order of the total center of mass energy. And this ends up being proportional to e squared, okay? And then, of course, you will have additional terms that belong to this set that I didn't write, okay? So same number of fields and increasing number of derivatives. And each time you include a derivative, you will have to add a power of e to make the dimension strong. So this is the first term, the 2-2-2 scattering. You see that there is a first term, which goes like this, so it's independent of capital lambda. And then there is a second term, which is dependent on capital lambda, but scales with the energy square. Okay. Now, before drawing our conclusions, let me go to a slightly more complicated example, which is the 2-4 scattering. Okay. Remember that I'm imposing the Zipf symmetry, so I can only consider an even number of phi particles in my amplitudes. So let me consider here a 2-2-4. So what are the terms? Well, you see, this is a 6 particle vertex. So this 5^6 will contribute. So this will give something like G1 over lambda squared. Now, do I need to worry about putting some factors of energies here? So looking at this operator, it wouldn't seem so, right? Because there are no derivatives around, so it seems strange that some energy factor should appear. And as a matter of fact, I should not, because you remember that this is a 6-point amplitude, so it must have a dimension minus 2 according to this formula. And from here, you see that this term is automatically dimension minus 2, so we're fine. And this is this term here with 6 phi particles. Now, can I construct some other terms that contribute to the 6-point amplitude? Well, yes, because you see, we have 4-point particle vertices around, and so I can glue together 2 4-point particle vertices to obtain the following thing. So I have, let me write it like this. I have 1, 2, three. So these are five, five, five. I exchange one particle five, and then I have other three, five particles. Okay. So you see that this is a quartic vertex that involves four particles. This is another quartic vertex because it involves four particles. And there is a propagator in between. Okay. So you have this term that, if you want, you can call a contact term. So there is no exchange of particles, everything comes here. And then there are these exchange, these diagrams that arise from the exchange of one five particle. Okay. Very good. So you see, I'm not wondering about what is a channel, the channel. I'm just hand waving the argument because it would be enough for us. So what is the contribution of this object? Well, we need to take the 4-point amplitudes, which is this one. So I have plus lambda plus h1 over lambda square e square. I take it twice because I have two quartic vertices. And then I need to divide to multiply by the propagator, okay? Which in my hand waving energy, in my hand waving way of considering energy, is something which is one over e squared. Okay. Remember that it's a massless scalar, so I don't have to worry about putting the mass here. So let me open up this term explicitly. Okay, so this thing is g1 over lambda square plus lambda squared divided by e squared, which is this term. Then I have plus h1 squared divided by lambda to the fourth e squared, which is the square of this term divided by this e squared. And then I have the cross product, which is something that goes like two times lambda h1 divided by lambda squared, with no energy dependence, because this energy dependence cancels out this one. Okay. Very good. So these were the two results to which I wanted to get. So now let's take the limit in which the energy at which the scattering happened is much less than the cutoff. Okay. So let me take in both cases the E much smaller than lambda. What are the terms that are important at very low energy? Well, from here, you see that this term goes to zero in this limit. So the only term that survives is lambda. So the only terms which is surviving here is the smallest dimensional one, the one in which I didn't have to suppress the dimension of the scattering by any power of lambda. What about in this more complicated example? Well, you see from here that in the E going to zero limit, this stays constant because there is no energy dependence. This also stays constant. This goes to zero, and this tends to become more and more important. So this is the term that survives. So this is something that goes like lambda squared divided by E squared. So again, we see that the only term that survives in the low energy limit, which is the long distance limit, is just the one which has connected or associated with the operator or smallest dimension. Okay. So this is precisely the same phenomenon that we saw when we were discussing the electrostatic potential of a charge distribution. The further away we go from the source, from the electrostatic distribution, then the fewer and fewer terms we need to consider. So in this analogy, this phi to the fourth is analog to the monopole. Then we have terms of order lambda square, or one over lambda square that emerges the same order, which are analog of the dipole. Then we will have orders here, terms here of order one over lambda to the fourth, which will be analog to the quadrupole, and so on and so forth. Okay. So as long as we are to sufficiently low energy, only the terms which contain operators of dimension four in my Lagrangian are important. Then as we move up with the energy, then the other terms start to be important until the energy becomes of order lambda and this series is meaningless. We don't have the right of use this series, and we need to change the description of our theory. So for instance, invoke a new quantum field theory with additional particles, or invoke something completely different, like a string theory, some other quantum gravity theory, or more exotic things. Okay, so historically, people were convinced that the terms of dimension four were special, okay, because they were able to do computations that made sense without having to invoke all the other terms. And these terms of dimension four, so equal four terms, are given a special name, and they are given the name of renormalizable. Terms. While the other terms of dimension larger than four are called simply non-renormalized. Now you need to pay attention, because if you look at very old books, by very old books I mean books written until 20 or 30 years ago, you will often see that the following claim, that only renormalizable theories are well defined. Well, this is an old view, okay? Since then we moved on. And the modern view is that all the theories in a limit in which the energy is sufficiently low can be described by renormalizable terms, okay? So they are important because they are the first one that we're gonna probe. Whenever we start doing experiments, we usually start from very low energy, we start to discover phenomena, and then we start to move up in energy and we start adding pieces. Okay, we're gonna see how this example works exactly in the case of the retroweak theory. We're gonna take this bottom-up approach and we're gonna construct our standard model with this approach. Okay, so it's not surprising that the lowest dimensional terms are the first that we can access, precisely because they are the only ones that survive in the very low energy. To access the other ones, we need to start increasing our energy, which is something which, from the practical point of view, experimentally, may be non-trivial. Okay, for instance, to discover the Higgs boson, it took 50 years since the formulation of the standard model. And because not only we needed a high energy, but also the properties of the Higgs bosons are such that this particle tends to hide itself. Okay. And so this is, so to conclude, this is the rationale behind the terms that we will write in all our interacting theories. Okay, so we'll always start with the renormalizable terms, which are those that are accessible at low energy. And then we will devote some words about the non-renormalizable terms, okay, which are those that can be accessed increasing the energy. Or, let me just point out that there are also other ways of detecting these terms. Suppose one or more of these terms give a phenomenon which is not predicted by the renormalizable path. Then measuring that phenomenon implies that we are accessing directly this non-renormalizable term independently on the energy to which we are working with. Okay, so this is a this searching for these phenomena that are not present in the renormalizable term is one of the most powerful probes that we have of the terms that are non-renormalized. Okay, very good. So just to close, let me stress one more that this is a very important point. There is absolutely nothing special a priori about the renormalizable terms or about the renormalizable theories. As a matter of fact, all theories, all quantum field theories, are renormalizable in the very low energy. Now, what happens when the energy increases is encoded in this set of non-renormalizable terms, as far as the energy is sufficiently below lambda, or once more, we need to change completely our description if we start going to energies which, instead of being smaller than lambda, are over lambda. Okay. Very good. So we are done with the part of the course in which I wanted to present you the ideas of quantum field theory. Next lecture, we are going to start to attack QED, and we're going to start to attack QED exactly from the non-renormalizable terms. And then later on, we will discuss quickly what happens with the non-renormalizable terms. So once more, thank you for your attention, and see you next lecture.